Hope y'all enjoy listening to those jams as much as I did. But I am so excited for tonight's last training. It's a little bittersweet because I'm so sad that we have to leave y'all. But I know y'all are all leaving with some of the best knowledge y'all can have. And I guess we'll just introduce ourselves and then Faith will get on with some housekeeping rules. So I'm Emerson Lyons and I'm your state secretary for this year.
I'm Bryson Johnson, and I'm Louisiana FFA's parliamentarian this year.
I'm Faith Thibodeau, and I'm your state sentinel. So just to kick off with a little housekeeping rules, tonight we're going to do a little thing called reflections at the end. So just remember when people are sharing and being vulnerable with each other, don't forget to be respectful. But even if you don't agree, it's okay, but we are going to respect others. So we're all area and state officers, so that's like a key thing is to be respectful. We're also going to be kind and open to other ideas. If we don't agree, that's okay. Or if someone has a really good idea, let them know it's a good idea and encourage them. Please keep your microphone on mute unless you're speaking. That way it'll kind of reduce some of the connection issues. I know that we had a little last night and it was a little loud. And please utilize the raise hand feature if you need to speak or if you want to say something. And to do that, you just go to reactions at the bottom of your screen and hit the raise hand feature, or it can also be in your participants list. It just depends on what kind of a device you're on. Okay, so that's all for my housekeeping rules. If y'all got it, just give me a thumbs up real quick. Just make sure we all got it. Yeah, it looks like everyone got it. Okay, so I think it's Bryson's turn.
Did Bryson introduce himself? Okay, awesome. So next, we're just going to do a little quick intro. We're going to do a poll real quick, and Mr. Lejeune is going to pop those up on your screens. So whenever they pop up, you can vote, and it's going to be a few questions. So dog or cat? All right. Alrighty, so we have about three more people. We'll give about five more seconds. All right, so the majority of us said dogs. Alrighty, and the next question is coming. Okay. So it's looking 50-50. Nothing popped up on your screen. Okay, Grace, I'm not too sure why nothing popped up on your screen, but you can try leaving the call and rejoining. You either. Okay, if y'all want, y'all can try leaving the call and then rejoining, or y'all can wait till the next question and see if it pops up for the next question. All right, so it was literally 50-50. Half of us like chocolate, some of us like vanilla. All right. Favorite dessert? Ooh, okay. All right. Okay, so we're about 50-50. That one was hard. I think it would have been hard for me too. Personally, I really like cookies. So. Favorite color? Or out of these two, at least. Yes, period. Dogs are always better than cats. Always. Okay, all right. All right, so blue won that one. Okay. All right, your favorite season? Hot, spring and summer, or cold, fall and winter? Personally, I like the summer because right now I'm freezing and I don't like this weather at all. This one's hard. All right, so it looks like majority of us said the hot weather. Personally, I love the hot weather because I love to go swimming and I love hanging out with my friends over the summer. Plus, there's a bunch of livestock shows. Favorite drink, coffee or tea? So it looks like coffee is winning right now. Iced sweet tea. Yeah. Well, as I shared with India and Lauren early this week, I'm a coffee addict. So personally, I would choose coffee. Favorite place to be, school or home? Yes, caramel coffee, Faith. Yes. School, okay. So school's losing. Oh, school's catching up. Okay. Oh, we're 50-50. Okay. 50-50. Wow. Okay. School versus home. All right. Personally, I really like going to school. And then I think we may be moving on to our last question. So preferred learning method, virtual or in person? For real. I'm so tired of being home. All right, so everyone said they much rather in person. So this little poll was just to show that there's always two sides to the equation. Everyone has their own opinion. And when it comes to giving a workshop, there's also two different methods you can go with. So as we hand it over to Bryson, let's pay attention and see what those two methods are.
All right, y'all, like Emerson said, there are two different ways to give information out to members, one of them being a workshop and one of them being a webinar.
Hold up.
First, let's start with workshops. Workshops are led by your audience, so therefore they're a lot more interactive with your audience. So with all that being said, you have to create a welcoming environment for your audience. One way to create a more welcoming environment is using inclusive language or inclusive words. Does anyone have any ideas on what inclusive language or inclusive words may consist of that they would like to share? Ethan, what do you think inclusive language may consist of?
Well, if I had to guess, I would say like pronouns. Like when you're talking to somebody, like saying we or they.
Yeah, right on, man. Right on. Exactly. So if I was to say, y'all, go write down three sentences about your dog. I sound like a teacher. You know what I'm saying? Like, I sound like I'm giving you orders. And a facilitator, or as a member, you're not really prone to want to do that. So if I was to say, now that we discuss different pets, let's write down three sentences about our dogs that we may have. Does anyone have any experience they've heard when they've been in a workshop or in a classroom and they heard someone else use inclusive language?
Bryson, can you repeat that? You had kind of cut out a little bit.
All right, my bad. Can anyone give an example of when they were in a workshop or in a classroom setting and someone used inclusive language? Caleb, you said I have. Would you like to share, man?
Yeah, so actually back in the, I want to say April, I did a workshop with one of the national officers, Mamie Hurdle, and she always used like inclusive language, like you said, like she used words like we and all that just to make sure that everybody was included.
Exactly. And another part of inclusive language is whenever you ask a question and you respond to that question, and you always make the person feel good about talking. So you always acknowledge their question, and you, even if it's wrong, you still say, great answer, awesome job. But you can't say the same thing for every person during one workshop while you're facilitating. So if I ask Faith a question and she gives me an answer, and I say, great job, and then I ask Emerson a question and she gives me an answer, I should say, awesome job. You know, change it up, because you don't want people, or you don't want members, to think that you're just saying it to say it. You should really make them feel welcome and good about being active. And like I said, workshops are audience driven, and through objectives and activities, they're learning a curriculum that they will use after the workshop and they'll practice for. Another thing is processing questions. Does anyone have any idea of what processing questions may be? How about Kirsten? What do you think a processing question may be?
Okay, so a processing question is a question that makes them think about the topic that they're either learning about or they're participating in. And it allows them to think about how they can get engaged along with it.
Exactly. That was spot on. So basically like jogs their memory and makes them brainstorm about what they're about to be learning. So they've already, before you teach them the curriculum, they've already started thinking about what they're going to be learning, and they're able to process it a lot better during the workshop. So yeah, workshops are very interactive and very audience driven. With that being said, what do y'all think a webinar may be as a member going through it? So what do y'all think it may consist of? And Dale, would you like to answer this one?
A webinar is basically doing a workshop on virtually. It's kind of having one person or a few people kind of giving people like advice or how to help them out with. Sometimes it's there to like teach people things.
Exactly. Great answer. Yeah, so webinars are give. My screen isn't showing. Okay. Webinars give a lot more information than workshops, and the audience makes a webinar. So when you're given a webinar, your audience is already in tune with what the information you're given. So with the workshop, it is a broader audience. So you may be given a workshop to, let's say, a ninth grade ag class. Some of those kids may be interested in different topics and different subjects, but you're still given the workshop, and you want everyone to be included in that workshop versus it's really more facilitator. So taking notes plays a huge role in workshops throughout the presentation. That really doesn't happen during a webinar. Really, questions just wait until the end or at the end of the slide. And it's really just a more of a Q&A instead of processing questions. So like my team and I, we went through a webinar with one of the national officers, and she was training us, and we took a lot of notes, and she talked majority of the time. So she didn't have to depend on us to really drive her presentation. So she had to come with a lot more information and a lot more curriculum in order to give to us. So with that being said, we're gonna break out into breakout rooms to start writing our own workshops. So while we're in these breakout rooms, your group will need to come up with three objectives and one topic for y'all's workshop. And there will be a facilitator in each breakout room to help y'all out.
So as we go into our breakout rooms, like Bryson said, we're going to be using what we've just learned today and over the past few days to kind of come up with three objectives and a topic for our presentation or our workshop. So did everyone receive my email with a shared Google Doc? Awesome. So what you're going to do is if you're on a computer, you can go ahead and go into that Google Doc and you can make a copy of it. So when you're on Google Docs, you're going to go to File. You'll hover your mouse over File, and then you'll see on the drop-down menu, you'll have an option to say make a copy. Go ahead and make that copy, title it whatever you want, and you can work in there. If you're on a phone and you're not able to do that, you can simply take notes and follow along with everyone in your breakout room so that way you can copy it later. Are there any questions, any clarifications that I can answer or Bryson can answer? Awesome. So Mr. Lejeune is going to be placing us in those breakout rooms shortly. So now we have our topics and our three objectives. I'm going to hand it over to Faith and let her go into her workshop or her area.
Okay, so now that we know like what our objectives are and like kind of what we're going to do our workshop on, I was talking to my small group about making sure that our workshops are fitting for a virtual format, because as we know, like so much of this year has been virtual and will probably continue to be virtual for at least a couple of months. So to ensure that it's virtual, to ensure that virtual workshops are successful, we want to access and utilize all the tools that these virtual workshops have. So virtual workshops and in-person are a little different, because in-person, you can see the reaction, you can see the body language, you can see their faces, and virtual, you can't see their computer screen. You don't know if they're buying backpacks or buying purses during your workshop, or if they're just online shopping or watching the LSU game or anything like that. So to kind of keep students engaged, my team and I this year have learned a few tips and tricks that we would like to share with y'all for your virtual workshops. So let's see, I'm going to share my screen real quick. Okay, can y'all see that? It should say sample. Okay, yeah, thumbs up. Okay, great. So this is a sample Zoom screen, and it should look, if you're on a desktop for sure, it should look a lot like the one that you see when we're presenting. So this green highlighted button says share screen, and that's the button that we use to share our PowerPoints and presentations with you. This is very useful, especially so you don't have to ship or mail documents or PowerPoint copies of PowerPoints to students, and they can see it during the presentation and follow along with you. And like I said, you just hit share screen right here. And then you just, it'll pull up different screens that you can share. You just select the one you want to look at. Now, if you'd like to share your audio, you can hit the arrow beside share screen and click advanced settings, and it will go into details on how to share your audio through that. You can also utilize this chat button. I know that we've been doing that quite a lot during our workshops, and that's just so people can talk back and forth without necessarily interrupting the instructor, or the instructor or workshop facilitator can see your responses to questions without having all 45 people talk at once. You can also record the workshop, which is really good if people aren't able to make it. So throughout the whole week, we've recorded all of our workshops, and they are posted onto Google Docs, and you'll all have access to them in case you need to rewatch them later. So it's a very handy tool for people who can't necessarily meet at the same time you're wanting to present. Then you have the closed captioning, and this is very helpful if you have students who are deaf or hard of hearing or anything. As some of you may know, in Area 4, we actually have a deaf chapter. So you Area 4 officers who are presenting, make sure that you have, if you know you have any deaf students, make sure you have your closed captioning on at least. And then we have breakout rooms right here. This button will divide you into breakout rooms. And when you click breakout room button, it will give you an option to do random assignments, and it will just split people into different rooms, or you can do specific assignments. And later on in the evening, we are gonna do a specific assignment room, and you'll kind of get to know more about that. Like all of Area 1 will be together, all of Area 2. And it takes a little bit longer, but it is super helpful if you need it. And then we have our reaction button right here. This button, you can show thumbs up, you can show the clapping emoji, you can show the smiling face emoji, and you can also do these under participants. It has several different ones for your participant. So if you're doing an activity on Zoom and you're like, okay, all those who got it, show me the thumbs up. You just click that thumbs up emoji, and that way, even if someone's camera's not working, you know that they got the material. Or we did several Zoom practices with Sarah when she was running for national officer candidate. And she utilized that thumbs up button a lot. She really used it to its fullest potential and made sure that it got used. And then we have this polls feature right here. So this is the feature that we used earlier in the meeting when we did the this or that activity. And that really helps students be involved because they have to answer. They can't just not answer it and be participant because it shows us who answers and who hasn't answered. So it really helps keep students engaged and not just sitting behind a computer screen all day. And so when you hit share screen, this is what comes up. So for me, it had screen one and that was my internet. And so I clicked that and I shared this screen with y'all. And then this is the share sound. So this is what I was talking about earlier. And this is how we play music throughout our workshops. So it's not just an awkward silence. And then there's the computer sound again. So we got that. And now we're gonna, let's see. So now that we're back in here, I'm gonna do a thing called a chalk talk. And it's very handy. You just go to the share screens button and where it has all those different windows, you just hit whiteboard and share. So can y'all all see the blank screen? Yep, okay, I'm assuming y'all can all see it. I see people writing on it. Okay, so this is great if you have students, if you want them to type, if you're doing a workshop and it's about ideas and you want ideas out of students, yeah, you can hit draw or you can hit text and have students write out their ideas or whatever. So just for practice, I want everyone to write or type their favorite animal.
How do you write on it, Faith?
I just use my computer mouse. Are you on a computer?
I can't do it either on a
computer. I'm on a Chromebook.
I'm on my Mac and I can't get it. You can't.
Did you hit draw at the top?
I don't have those options.
I don't have that option.
Yeah, whenever you click share, it says host does not allow.
Oh, okay. Let me see if I can.
Parse disabled. I think it's because we're in Chromebook, which kind of like.
It's a little small pin in the left corner, the left bottom corner of the screen. If you click on it, you'll see like pin, arrow color, and so forth.
Yeah. It shows that everyone should be able to draw on it. Are y'all on like your school provided Chromebooks?
Yes.
I'm on my regular laptop and I don't have the option.
I'm not on my school laptop and I don't have the option to share.
You don't share your screen. She's sharing it. The person that's providing the whiteboard is sharing it. So only she is. So like Lauren said, there's going to be a pencil icon on the corner, on the bottom. Yeah. If you're looking at your screen, the bottom left corner on top of the mute and unmute button, and it should be right there.
I did not see that.
I'm going to stop sharing it real quick and I'm going to reshare it and see if that helps. Okay.
All right, thank you.
You're welcome. Let's see. Okay. Does everyone see it or no?
I still don't.
You still don't see it?
Okay. I don't see the little icons.
Try clicking. Like I said, try clicking as if you're going to unmute yourself and see if it pops up.
I don't really see it at all. I want to show up about it.
Layla, what kind of device are you on?
It's just my regular laptop. It's not a Chromebook.
You should definitely be able to see that.
And she said it's over the mute button.
It's just near the mute button at the bottom.
Yeah, no, I don't have anything.
Do you see the share screen button?
Yes.
Okay, click share screen and see if it gives you the option.
For me, it's just applications.
Okay.
Is that where it is?
Try there.
It's just giving me an option for whiteboard, but it's like gonna let me share it, I think.
Okay, click it and see what happens, because I have it set where only the host can share screen.
Okay, can y'all see me writing?
It says I'm sharing the screen.
Yeah, you see it's making me share.
Okay. I see you, Layla.
You can see Layla writing?
Yeah,
see like y'all individually, like talking.
Okay, gotcha. Well, this is it's under the share screen. So as long as you can see it under the share screen option, just make sure that you remember that as a tool that you can use when you share workshops. And if it doesn't work, you can always get them to send their answers in the chat. So when we did workshops for National Officer Summit, we utilized Whiteboard. And for some people, it didn't work, just like it is now. I don't know if it's a thing with Chromebooks or if just for some people it doesn't work well. And we use the chat feature to just type our answers and send them in there. So you can always do that rather than just not having them participate. But this does give students a little bit more creativity and a way to participate and, again, not just sit there and be bored throughout the presentation. So I'm going to stop sharing that now. And another thing that we use to, like, keep students engaged are, like, activities. Y'all know how in-person – okay, first of all, how many of us have been to leadership camp? Just give me, like, a thumbs up. You can use that reaction thumbs up so we make sure we all know how to use it correctly. Perfect. It looks like a lot of us have been to leadership camp. So y'all know at leadership camp, we always play some like silly, goofy activity before we start, right?
Right.
Yeah. So when we're doing this, it all ties back into the workshop. Well, when you're doing that virtually, you can't really have students running around and jumping on tables to get away from the lava. So we have to figure out a way how to incorporate that virtually. So what we figured out is QR codes. You know how we sent that GroupMe earlier in the week in the chat on the QR codes and you just scan it over your phone? Those are miracle workers. So if you can go online and make free QR codes and attach any online game with it. For example, if you go type in Pac-Man on Google, it'll pull up the Pac-Man game and you just attach it to that QR code. And those instructions are given on any QR code website. And you have a Pac-Man QR code. And then your team can play Pac-Man and you can relate that to your workshop. Also, you don't even have to use the QR codes. You can just go on Google and type in Pac-Man. So do we all have our, Rachel, I think you're accidentally, there you go. Okay. So do we all have phones or like mobile devices with us that can get on the internet? Okay. So everyone, go on Google. I'm sorry, Stephanie, what did you say?
I don't have data right now.
Okay, that's okay. Do you have your computer with you? Are you on your computer? Yes, okay, open a tab on your internet and type in Pac-Man, and we're all going to play one round of Pac-Man real quick, okay? So you'll have about 3 to 5 minutes to play this game. This is what it's going to look like once you get it put up and you just hit, okay, I don't know why I'm doing that, but it's just going to have the game and you just hit play, okay?
Send me your location, let's focus on communicating, cause I just need the time and place to come through. Send me your location, let's ride the vibrations, I don't need nothing else but you.
Hey, sorry, I had to go BRB for a little bit, so what was the do a quick rundown of just a couple minutes ago?
Yeah, we're all playing Pac-Man on our phones right now. So if you'll just go to, if you'll just go to Google and type in Pac-Man, it should give you the option to play it real quick. We're gonna play for a couple more minutes, okay?
Alrighty.
I wonder why I fool with you, but this is new to me. This is new to you initially. I didn't wanna fall, but you gather my attention. It was all for you, so don't. Take advantage, don't leave my heart damaged. I understand that things go a little bit better when you plan it. Oh, so won't you send me your location? Let's focus on communicating, cause I just need the time and place to come through. Send me your location, let's ride the vibrations. I don't need nothing else but you. I don't wanna fall in love off of some tweet, so let's get personal. I got a lot of cool spots that we can go. Tell me what's the move and I got you. I'm only acting like this cause I like you. Just give me the vibe to.
Okay, so has everyone had the opportunity to play at least one round? Yeah, just give me a thumbs up. That'd be great. Perfect. Okay. So now that was a little bit more interesting and engaging than just sitting and listening to a lecture or someone lecture on and on and on, right? So these are like tips and tricks that you can use when as area officers to present like cult conference and stuff and keep students more involved. That's something I really enjoyed about the virtual because it's very, even though you are at home and you're sitting just staring at a computer screen, there are plenty of ways to keep students involved and keep them active. So now that we've talked about that, let's talk about the students who are always a little bit too active. So these are the students who are like talking during your workshop. They're not really paying attention. They don't really care what you're talking about. And they kind of cause trouble. So we all know that, or those of us who have been to leadership camp, the ones who the state officers have to kind of tap and be like, okay, like quiet down. Let's tune back into our workshop. Let's focus more on leadership and stuff and less on what happened 2 weeks ago. So in person, that's a little bit kind of hard because you don't want to come off as someone who's better than or older than. You just want to be like, hey, that's not cool. Pay attention. So on virtual, it's way easier. So on three, everyone is going to just start talking. Everyone's going to unmute your microphone and just start talking about random stuff. Like it doesn't have to do anything with FFA, just keep it appropriate. So 1, 2, 3.
I love chocolate milk.
Yeah, man, I just tripped over a rock yesterday. It's not supposed to trip.
So cold.
Like I felt sweaty on my face.
Okay, so on Zoom, it's super easy just to go hit the mute all button and no one can talk. You can even if you have problems with kids unmuting themselves, you can just hit mute all and don't allow to unmute. So that's very handy because you don't have to be like, hey, stop talking. You can just mute them and they're done talking. So that's something that I really enjoy. Because I did a workshop a couple weeks ago and there were some people talking. I just slid my mouse over and clicked and they were done talking. So it really helps as a facilitator if you don't have to try to compete with their attention. Because on Zoom, if someone else is talking, it kind of amplifies them and highlights their screen. So people are paying attention to them so they know who's talking. So it's just easy to mute them all. Also, I don't know if y'all noticed, but when all of y'all were talking, you couldn't understand anybody. And it was very like spotty and not very clear. Can this be available in real life? Yeah, Rachel, I agree 100%. But when everyone's talking at once, you can't hear what's going on. So it's just easier to mute all and then have students use that raise their hand feature. So you can call on them and then they can unmute individually. So now that we have seen all these amazing features that Zoom offers, we actually have one more to go over and then we'll go on. But social media, a lot of us don't think of social media as related to workshops. So what my team has learned this year is that once you present a workshop, you can use social media to see students' engagement. I don't know if those who attended virtual leadership camp this year, we posted every day like one thing we learned throughout the day. And that's a way to make sure students are actually taking what you're talking to them about. And even in Sydney's workshop the other day, she got y'all to post something on your social medias. So it's a very good way to see students' engagement throughout the year. Let's see.
Faith, yeah, real quick. So I have family coming in tonight and I'm gonna have to leave a little early, like right now. Is that okay? I talked to Mr. Lejeune earlier and he said I'll just have to finish the workshop template.
Yeah, that's fine. It's like I said earlier, it's all recorded and I think you all have access to it. And if not, we can get you access to it. So yeah, you're fine. I'm glad you got to come tonight though.
Yeah. I will just have to finish the template though. That's what I'll have to do.
Yeah. Just finish that template.
Okay.
Bye. See you later, Kristen. Bye. So it's really good to just utilize all your social media and all these outreaches that we have on Zoom. So to wrap this up, we are going to go back into our breakout rooms and we're going to figure out how we can incorporate all these different activities, whether it's the games, the polls, the sharing of the screen, the music, the reactions into our workshop. And we're going to come up with different activities that feature all of these different tools, okay? So do we have any questions? Okay, and there will be a facilitator in all of your breakout rooms to answer any questions that you may come up with.
So Bryson said, was it Bryson? I think it was Bryson. Someone said in the chat, their group had a really good idea. Would y'all like to start the sharing?
I could start sharing, if that's okay.
Yeah.
So we were talking about how to be an effective leader. And we were talking about how we could use like icebreakers and processing questions to convey our points.
Awesome. Yeah. Icebreakers are great, especially for getting groups to get to know each other and introduce your topic. Would anyone else like to share? Alrighty, if no one else wants to share, we are going to dive into the next topic of our workshop, and I will share my screen real quick. Alrighty, so this portion of the training tonight is just going to be some of the virtual do and don'ts when it comes to virtual facilitation and virtual processing. So virtual versus in-person, it's different, but it's comprehensible. So what is processing? I know we kind of went over it last night. Bryson also went over it, but just to really rock solid, put in stone, processing is the universal key to hitting and achieving your objectives within your workshop. Some examples of processing, there's two main examples. One is facilitator front loading, and the other is a question and answer style. And the two sub styles are participant driven and independent reflection. So just to go a little deeper, front loading. This is where the facilitator completely drives the discussion. This is going to be in your workshop when your facilitator is just really trying to relay that information to you and hit those key points so that you're learning and the facilitator is able to drive the conversation. So all the points are put on the PowerPoint in some sort. These are the points that all students will be learning, and the points are verbalized throughout the webinar or the workshop. So Q&A, it's pretty much in the title. It's straightforward, asking questions and someone answering. So this could be to the point of the facilitator asking a question and then everyone responding in the chat, or using the features like Faith said with our reactions, our hand raising features, and responding like that, or just having a smaller discussion in breakout rooms. So that can be used really in person and in virtual. It works extremely well in virtual when you really want your audience to relay the information that you just taught them. So participant driven, this is where you place students in breakout rooms, give them a prompt or in a certain amount of time to discuss. So that's kind of what we've been doing tonight in the breakout rooms when we've been creating our workshops. We've been letting y'all kind of guide the conversation, see what ideas y'all have, and putting that down on paper. So independent reflection, this can be like Sydney, Sadie, and Elizabeth used on Monday, the social media use. You can do a journal prompt, or you can simply just have a reflection question where the students sit down and think about the question and they process it. So in-person processing. Front loading can still be used. It looks about the same and it's normally followed by an interactive activity. So webinars aren't normally something in-person, but if this was an in-person AOT, AOT is normally extremely informative and we're almost front-loading y'all with a lot of information that we just want y'all to absorb. So normally we just give y'all the information and we follow by a really fun reflective activity. Q&As can still be used in person, but they look a little different. And you can start the question, let it branch out to go wherever you want, really gets those gears turning. Participant driven, it shows understanding, builds confidence, and it's not as hard and awkward as in person. So I know I can speak for myself. When we did leadership camp over the summer, I felt like it was so awkward the first day because we were behind a screen and none of the members really wanted to talk or put their answer in first. And so some of the state officers started answering for us, and that's really what got the conversation going. So when you're in a workshop or you're doing a webinar, that can be a huge problem, especially over Zoom or virtual. It's hard to get students involved sometimes. So your fellow officers or chaplain members may have to butt in and just kind of get that conversation going. So independent reflection in person can be the same exact way as it is virtually. You can give them a prompt, let them use it on social media, just independently reflect on it or write it down as a mission statement or a goal. So virtual processing, we kind of went over this, but this just really goes in detail of what it looks like. So front loading is going to be a PowerPoint. It's an informative talk. Everyone stays muted normally and you type questions in the chat. And it's more of a lecture more than anything. Q&A, just like we said before, question and answer, participant driven, and super easy to use in both settings. Participant driven, this does become harder. Like I just said, it becomes a little awkward. And sometimes you have to think on your toes to get students involved. So this can be when you want to really get students involved, you can use a clap back. So I know something that we use at in-person leadership camp was like, hey, burrito, and everyone had to say it back. So I know personally, when I did a chapter visit, I couldn't use hey, burrito because everyone would unmute themselves and it would just be the exact same way Faith did with her example. Everyone was talking and it was just super hectic and all you hear was hey, burrito. So something you could do is, all right, everyone put a number one in the chat if you like chocolate milk. Kind of catches everybody's attention, stops the side conversations, and puts the attention back on the workshop. Independent reflection can be a prompt, self-reflection, a mission statement, or a social media journal. So interaction. We kind of been talking about this yesterday and today. In person, it's easier to handle in some aspects. There is more people to help manage the control of your room. And also the vibes and the energy can be really pumped up when you're in person. So like at State Convention, when we have pre-sessions, it is like so pumped up in there. It's it's hype. And that's just a little harder to achieve when you're virtual. So when we play music and like I straight up dance, I will dance for y'all. If y'all record me, y'all record me. But that's the whole point of really using, thinking on your toes and using everything you have when you're virtual. So when you are virtual though, it's easier to control your noise in your room, just like Faith did earlier. She muted everyone when everyone was talking. It's really easy to control your room. And like Rachel said, I wish it was something we would have in person because it would be amazing. So sometimes, like I said earlier, it can be really hard to get students involved. And this is where you can rely on your chapter officers, your fellow officers, or even state officers to help, depending on what setting you're in. And when you're virtual, you always have to have backup plans, even when you're in person. But I feel like virtual, you really always have to have a backup plan because anything could just not work out and technology could just cut it. So if there are no questions, we're going to go back into our breakout rooms and really just perfect those magic formulas in our workshops and finish off any loose ends that we have. And we'll take about 10 minutes to do so. And once we're done, we'll come back to this main room and then Faith will introduce us to our next activity. So I hope that the last activity, we really got to know each other. I know we had a couple laughs in our group, but we really did get personal and really share, you know, what the topic was. So personally, I would just like to thank every single person in here, every single area officer. This has been such a great past 3 days. I hope y'all learned so much. I enjoyed spending time with y'all each night. And we're going to hand over to Ms. Lejeune after, if Faith and Bryson have anything left to say.
Thank y'all so much for being so great this week. If y'all ever need anything, me, Faith, and Emerson, we have officer accounts. Do you want to just stick them in the chat, y'all? Or here, I'm just going to put my Snapchat. If y'all ever need anything, just let us know. And if we don't have the answer or no, we will definitely get it for y'all.
Yeah, like Bryson said, our doors are always open. Like, and not just me, Emerson and Bryson, like our whole team. We're always available for y'all to call, Snapchat, text. Just please don't give our phone numbers out because that could be creepy. But y'all are always welcome to use them. So, and we just want to thank y'all for coming and showing up because I don't know about y'all, but I had a good time this week. And I know that my fellow officers had a good time this week.
Thank you all for joining us the past few days. If you would, just make sure you tell the state officer team how thankful you are for them. I've told everybody this since the start of COVID. There's a lot of people in the state who thought that the easiest thing would be just to shut it all down and let's just wait for COVID to end. And I was not a fan of waiting around for months and months and months and months for this to stop. I know that virtual is not ideal, but it's a whole lot better than nothing. And I think the quality can still be really good. And this state officer team has still made a really big impact in our state this year. It's not the most visible necessarily like it's been in years past, but they're on the road, they're on the move, they're doing a good job. And doing this area officer training for you was a really important thing that the state officers felt we needed to do. We needed to do it before the year ended. So thank you for being so attentive and participating. Reach out to us. There are gonna be opportunities this year. There are silver linings to virtual. It's making things a little more accessible. So there will be some opportunities for all of you to do chapter visits with the state officers. We're possibly going to look at doing industry visits in the springtime that we want to take area officers on now that you've gone through AOT and have some training to go along with that. So be on the lookout. I know we invited the Area 1 officers to do a chapter visit with her come in January. So we will have more of that to offer you here over the spring semester. Keep your fingers crossed. Hopefully COVID gets crushed in the springtime and things are going to get a whole lot better. I think there's light at the end of the tunnel. And I think springtime could be really good for us. So before we finish, there's a couple of things. I'm about to drop a link in the chat bar. It's a survey for this conference. It won't take you but maybe 3 or 4 minutes to answer. If you would go through it, fill it out. I'm also going to email it to the area officer group tomorrow for people that weren't on the call tonight to be able to do it. If you finish the survey tonight, don't retake it tomorrow when I send it again. You're also going to be getting information from the state officers in the next several days. It may be after Christmas. I'll talk to them this weekend. We'll figure out the plan on it. One of the assignments that you're going to have is to put together a short virtual workshop, and the state officers are going to critique you. So we'll send out more information on that, along with a sign-up link for you to pick a time to practice with the state officer. So be on the lookout for that. Like I said, it could be over the next few days. It may be after Christmas break. I know we're getting to the end of it, but that'll be your next big assignments. I did visit with your area advisors on Monday. They've got some pretty cool ideas for you too in the springtime. I found out some cool new things today that we're going to be rolling out for you also in January. So be on the lookout. So I'm going to drop this here in the chat bar. You should be able to click on it and go straight to the survey site. And then that's all I've got. So state officers, if you don't have anything else, whenever they're done, I think they can log off.
All right, if you don't mind, I'm just gonna play some more music so it's not awkward silence while we take this quiz or this.